I am really getting sick and tired of getting Commodore computers without power supplies. Or worse, with a power supply that'll do more harm than good. So let's build a universal bench power supply for any Commodore computer that used an external power brick, starting right now. This is part one of a two-part series. This video will take a look at the need, the design premise, and the parts required for building this universal power supply. There are also some companion posts on our website, which I'll link in the description below. Shortly after releasing the power supply video last year, I received this Commodore 64 from eBay. It was packaged much better than normal, but of course, the black brick of death was suspect. I also got this machine not too long after, and this one came with no power supply at all.
Well, there's some padding anyway.
Well, the first time it occurred to me that a bench power supply would be a nice thing to have was when I got this machine with the black brick of death. When I tested it, I was horrified to find out that it's putting out 12 volts on the 5 volt line. It's a freaking nightmare! And of course the auction stated that they hooked it up and the red light came on. So I was kind of happy to see when I tested it that it seemed to work just fine. But when I hooked it back up a little while ago, the SID is now totally borked. I find it's a pain in the neck to test the power supplies with the shield around the DIN connector. So what I did is I just took a spare female DIN, because a lot of the connectors I ordered came with females as well as the males. I just added some leads so it's easy to hook up and test, and you just plug the power supply into it and it makes it easy to check with the meter. This also gave me the opportunity to put Ray Carlson's C64 saver to the test. And as you can see, the LED lights up red and is not passing through any voltage. So my solution is to build a power supply for my bench that will provide all the voltages for any machine I'm likely to see, plus provide some current and voltage monitoring for me. This power supply will provide all the possible voltages needed to a single connector on the front panel. So then I can build a connector for each type of power supply that uses only the voltages it needs and provides the correct connector for the computer. So I'm going to add a second connector that only provides 5 and 12 volts. So what this is for is external floppy drives that use a power brick like this 1541-2. The first step was to figure out what voltages will be needed and what the maximum current that might be drawn for each voltage. In addition, since I wanted to allow for a computer and an externally powered disk drive simultaneously, I had to take that into account. I created a quick spreadsheet that I could use to organize this information and determine the number of pins needed on a connector to provide all of these. The spreadsheet can be viewed on the blog post in the description below. Based on this, it looks like we're going to need an 8-pin connector, including separate connectors for the ground and the common. The earliest VIC-20 computers require 9 volts AC at 3 amps, which can be difficult to find for the North American 110-volt system. So I looked for a long time for one of these that would work at 110 volts. And finally, a kind person in one of the Commodore Facebook groups pointed out this one on DigiKey. By using the dual windings in parallel, we can get the needed 9 volts AC at 3 amps. But if you don't need to support these early machines, then you can save about $20 by using a common 9 volt AC 1 amp wall wart. These aren't made anymore, but I find them all the time at garage sales, thrift shops. I even found a new old stock one at my friendly local electronics store. This is more than sufficient to meet the needs for the Commodore 64 and the later VIC-20s. In fact, this is exactly what I used in my first power supply video. Another oddball requirement is the Commodore 16 and 116. They run on a 9 volt DC wall wart at only 1 amp. Adding this into the supply would be fairly trivial, and you can do it, but it seems kind of pointless to me. I suppose if you wanted to set up voltage and current monitoring, which we're going to talk about later, you could certainly add this in. On this prototype, I've left room for it on the connector, but I am not adding it at this time. So let's run down the parts needed for this project. Since this is a test build, I would like to incorporate any ideas you have into the final product, so please leave any suggestions you have in the comments below. So the core DC power supply I chose is the Meanwell RT65B. This is an off-the-shelf switching power supply that provides 5 volts, 12 volts, and negative 12 volts in sufficient current for all of our needs. For the AC 9 volts, I have this transformer that I got from DigiKey thanks to the help in finding it. These cost about $20, so again, if you don't need to support the early Type 1 and 2 VIC-20s, then just going with a wall wart would be just fine. I'm using these dual display panels I picked up. They'll work for DC voltage and current monitoring and don't need a separate power supply of their own for voltages up to 28 volts. Assuming that they work well, their price is also really attractive. I was able to get a set of 3 for only $10. I want this supply to be affordable enough that you can make one without breaking the bank. So the idea of this power supply is you're going to put a separate pigtail on for each computer. So you're going to need those front connectors. My first instinct was to use Molex connectors, but as I looked into them, I got the tools to put them together. I got the connectors. These things are freaking expensive. It's ridiculous. And then I found these Aviation connectors. They have the look I originally envisioned and they feel really solid, especially considering how affordable they are. Of course, how well they'll work remains to be seen. The other end of the cables will need the correct connectors for each Commodore computer. So I found that the best source for Commodore 64, 128, and Amiga connectors is Jeff Burt's Sojourners. The one exception is the 4-pin connector needed for the external drives. These have a decent soldering cup, so hopefully they'll work well since Sojourners doesn't have them. So it's going to be absolutely critical that your C128 and your Amiga connectors are kept separate and marked well. Commodore used the same connector for both computers, but they didn't have compatible voltages. So 5 volts is on the same pin, but where the Commodore 128 has 9 volts AC, the Commodore Amiga has plus and minus 12 volts. Not really a good thing to mix up. So I don't yet have any connectors for the early VIC-20s and the Commodore 16 and 116, because I don't have any of those computers. If you have any suggestions of a good place to get them, then let me know in the comments below. And I'll add that information to the description for this video, as well as to the blog posts on my website. Keep in mind that you may not want to go out and buy all the connectors, because you may well just be able to salvage a connector off of a bad power supply, like this one. So there's a few other parts, including a external AC connector with an externally located, manually operated ONOFF modulator and a fuse. You're also going to need some 5-conductor power cable. And yes, I know that I said the front panel will have an 8-pin connector, but no single computer uses more than 5 of those. For the cable, I'm going to try some 20 AWG. The 18's a little too big. The 22's a little too small. Now, to bring it all together, you're going to need an enclosure, and of course you've seen this sitting here the whole video. I originally was going to use this Jameco one, but I was a little optimistic on how much I could pack into this enclosure. I finally settled on this one. It came off of Amazon. I just really like the size, and this blue just screams Commodore, at least to me. So the only real issue with it is the included steel covers are not grounded to the frame, so if you use the front covers, you will need to ground them. So for this prototype though, I'm going to be using plastic 3D printed panels that my friend Tom designed and printed for me. I'll include several options in a blog post for the panels, including dimensions for cutting your own from plastic or the included steel panels. There's also the option of 3D printing them, of course. I met my good friend Tom at the Commodore Amiga user group meetings in 1988, and we worked actively with the group for many, many years. He designed and printed these panels on his 3D printer using a textured bed, and they look freaking gorgeous. Now that we've figured out all the parts, what we need to do is get a plan and get it all put together. It's a lot of wiring to do. It's a little bit complicated with the meters getting it set up correctly. Right now what we've got is an empty box with some panels on it, so that really doesn't do a whole lot. So these have all got to be wired up. We've got the main connector that's going to feed the computers. We've got the secondary connector here that's for the external disk drive. So these have all got to be wired and connected. AC power, the power supply, and the transformer will have to go in there. get hooked up properly. Lots of cabling connectors, so I'll have to make several pigtails. So once it's finished, it can live on the bench, and whenever I'm working on a machine, I don't have to worry about having a good power supply. So the plan is this is for the external floppy drive. That'll only have 5 and 12 volts on it. This is to monitor the 5 volt voltage and current that's going to the floppy drive. So if you're diagnosing a drive on the 5 volt line, you'll see how much current's being drawn. Over here, I didn't see a real point in connecting the negative 12 volts. So the Amigas draw like a tenth of an amp or something. It's a tiny amount on the negative 12 volts. I honestly don't even know that you need to have the 12 volts on here. I went ahead and put it on here since I had three of these just to see how it worked and to experimentally, as I'm working and using this, I'll see if that's useful. So with the 5 volts current being monitored here, you'll be able to tell if the voltage is being pulled down excessively, then it gives you a clue that maybe something's going on in the machine. You'll see the increased amount of current being drawn, give you an idea that the machine has got something wrong, it's got a short. So if you have any suggestions, I'm going to be wiring this up this week and getting the next video out as soon as I can. That's going to be the real telltale on this. In the meantime, there's two blog posts up on my blog, one of them covering the parts, one of them covering the initial design ideas. That spreadsheet's up there. If you have suggestions, send them to me. Put them in the comments. You can send me a message on the blog. So I hope you've enjoyed this video. And as soon as the next video's done, I'll put a link to it right here. In the meantime, here's something else you might like.